You know, I came home last night and I tried to think of how I was going to do this video today. It went until the very, very late hours of the morning, and still, even half a day removed from what we saw at WrestleMania last night. There aren't really words. Now, some people might say, oh, it's just a TV show, it's just fake, scripted. That's not important. This man, Mark Calloway, aka The Undertaker, went out for the better part of a decade. No, I'm sorry. He went out there for 30 years. He was out there longer than I've been alive, almost. And he was not in good shape. He was hurting. That man suffered that match. Why? For you. For me. For the 75,000 in attendance and the millions and millions around the world watching on the WWE Network. He put together his final masterpiece. He did everything he could. Did all that he had to do to try and put Roman Reigns over. And he did. Jim Ross was there. Jim, the voice of the Attitude Era Ross. The man that has inspired thousands of memorable moments and countless people to pursue their dream as a commentator. Am I going to say I wasn't affected by him? No, because I was. Everybody wants to be that iconic. But we witnessed the end of an era that night. The dead man is no more. I looked at it. I watched it. I almost cried. It still gets me now. That's why I had to come in here and do this. Because we will never. And I mean ever see that again. The Shawn Michaels retirement comes to mind for me. WrestleMania 25, where he put it all on the line, couldn't end the streak, should have, but no. There's people that have said he didn't even like the streak. He hated it. But at the end of the night, what happened in that show, it will forever be etched in history as The Undertaker's last ride. Personally, his entrance was what we all expected. He'd come rising out of the ground halfway down the ramp. His entrance still took 4 minutes. 4.5 minutes, actually. But he gave it all he had. did everything that you could even possibly think to do. Chair shots, going through an announce table. But at the end, when you saw him, I think that he made that decision very much on the moment when he'd gotten his jacket and he'd gotten his hat. He was walking up the ramp. He stopped. He's like, I think this is where he had been the entire night contemplating. Like, I think that beforehand he wasn't certain. Like, could I do another match? At the end of that match, having gone the lengths that he did, I think he said, no. I can't put myself through that again. It was too painful. So, he stopped. He turned around. Everybody was chanting, "Thank you, Taker." And the minute he stood in the middle of that ring and started unlacing his gloves, I knew. It hit hard, like a freight train. To see the dead man put it down. Then he took off the jacket, folded it, put it on top of the gloves, and last but not least, the hat. He took it off like he normally did, both hands down. And he set it down. I think at that moment, we weren't looking at The Undertaker anymore. We were looking at Mark Calloway, a man who has thrown himself through so much in his life, done so much for this business, that was him saying, "The Undertaker now rests in peace." He walked over, he kissed his wife. He walked halfway up the ramp, back to the ring, raising the single fist, lowered down into darkness. With all the great things that happened this night, that will be it. That will be the moment. I didn't like, you know, Roman Reigns before that. I don't like him now. I understood why it had to happen the way it did. His attitudes after, if you're gonna break it, go ahead and break it, you know? Shatter it. He should have, after the pinfall, just, you know, helped The Undertaker to his feet, embraced him, just like Taker did with Shawn Michaels, just like Undertaker did with Triple H and Shawn Michaels. Embrace him, break it, don't hold it. But he walked up the ramp. I'm going to very cursorily, very, very quickly go over the rest of the card because there's not a lot else that matters. And I had drank quite a bit, so I'm still kind of hungover. Austin Aries versus Neville to start the show. was very good. Neville wins. I believe that I called that. Aries will continue to chase. A little bit of, what you call shenanigans in the match towards the end, because he had his submission locked in, and he was under Austin Aries, and, you know, he got some fingers in the eye, and then, like, Neville hit his, hit the red arrow for the win. What was next? The Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal. Now, I had pegged out Braun Strowman to win as kind of a thank you for jobbing to Roman Reigns, but no. My secondary pick was, if they wanted to do something interesting, they could throw a bone to Luke Harper because he was there. That didn't happen either. My third pick was Sami Zayn, because, again, throwing him a bone for all the things they've been putting him through. Again, he was one of the last eliminated, but he did not win. He didn't come close. Well, he came closer than Luke Harper or Braun Strowman. But in the end, it came down to Jinder Mahal and Mojo Rawley, Rob Gronkowski, aka Gronk, who's jacked up on something, I don't know, got in the ring, because of course he did. Odds on, if you know a celebrity has a connection to the WWE and is therefore featured on camera, 9 times out of 10 that person's getting involved in some fashion. And he did. He helped Mojo Rawley beat Jinder Mahal, and Mojo Rawley now gets to put that on his resume. It's not impressive. Certainly didn't deserve it in my eyes, but there you go. Oh, what else we got? On the pre-show, because that took up a good chunk of time, the New Day came out dressed in Stormblood, Final Fantasy XIV Stormblood gear, inspired gear. I'm told that Xavier was a monk, looking like the monk. He had a Moogle in Francesca 2, Turbo. He had a Moogle right there near the Baffle, which is the horn part of the horn. My geek cred showing out there. Band geek. Played alto sax, by the way. Fun fact for everybody. Big E was a samurai. He had the big coin plate in front, and it read The New Day. His scabbard read New Day. Kofi was a red mage, but I didn't know that, because when I looked at him, I was like, oh, he's a swashbuckler. Because he had a rapier, he was wearing, you know, the pirate hat and big feather and all reddish. And I'm like, there you go, dude. Very good. They come out there to, you know, officially start the WrestleMania show. That was another moment that I remember. The women's match. Nia Jax was eliminated first. Meh. You know. Not real big on it. Didn't really care. What have you. Charlotte looked like... Charlotte was a peacock for whatever reason. Because of course she was. my husband making the reference to a Katy Perry song. And one of my friends made that joke while we were sitting there. I don't like that song. Mostly because my husband would play it during the final days of the establishment we both worked at on end until somebody pulled the disc out. So, there's that. AJ... What? Maybe. AJ Styles versus Shane McMahon. There was only one way this was going. Shane busted out a frickin' moonsault. Shooting star press. It was beautifully done. And because he's a stuntman, you know? There was a couple spots in here where you knew they were letting Shane do what Shane does best to make a match look amazing. I mean, there was a ref bump. Like, he got hit with an enziguri from AJ Styles because Shane ducked. And he tried to set Shane up for a coast-to-coast, did a flying nothing, got hit in the face with a trash can at a really hard bump because he was flying and it didn't even look like he was stopping his momentum. But he jumped and Shane threw the trash can at him, right down to the mat right there. Shane set him up for the coast-to-coast with another trash can hit. But when he busted out that shooting star press, he didn't hit it. He also didn't hit another... He tried for another announce table elbow drop. Didn't hit it. Yeah. And not, like, as bad as he had, like, missed or botched the one he did on SmackDown. He just... AJ moved out the way. AJ Styles won because of his ability to, you know, move out the way for the moonsault. So there you go. Back to the Raw Women's Championship match. Bayley retained. There was no Sasha heel turn. The mixed tag match between Maryse and John Cena, Maryse and Miz, John Cena and Nikki Bella. I didn't really watch it because I was trying to sober up a bit. I didn't want to be too bad. So, you know, I went outside, had a soda, sat, everybody was smoking. Everybody was talking, you know, just back and forth. Chatter with friends. Those ones that really make memories you don't remember. But apparently, Cena and Bella won, and then John proposed right there in the middle of the ring. I saw that one coming, although I had hoped that they would put over, you know, Miz and Maryse. But it is what it is. The SmackDown Championship, the SmackDown Women's Championship six-pack challenge. We all knew where this was going when Naomi showed up on Thursday. We knew it. Tuesday last week. We knew where this was going. So we got Naomi hitting the rear view and then putting her in some sort of submission. Like double arms like this. Like really close in and squeezing. And she's like, oh, I gotta tap out. And She made Alexa Bliss tap. After doing a not terrible suicida, like between the ropes dive towards the announce table side, wasn't bad. One of the stupidest endings to one of the matches that shouldn't. There was another match. There are two matches here that I was super hyped for and that I fucking hated the ending of. The first was Baron Corbin versus Dean Ambrose. This was again on the pre-show. Sorry if I'm, you know, throwing y'all off. He went through Baron Corbin and beat him. I think, if I remember correctly, Baron Corbin was going for the end of days. Swung him, because he like swings them back. He swings them forward and then plants them on their face. So he swings him back. Dean flips behind him, comes over his head, grabs him, hooks like one arm good, the other one kind of half-hearted. Hits the dirty deeds. 1, 2, 3, done. The other match that I was super hyped for was Bray Wyatt, Randy Orton. Dude, Randy Orton did not need to win this. This destroyed Bray Wyatt because his credibility was the fact that He was in Randy's head. Randy should not have won this. And there was a couple times during the match where they like did something crazy, but I don't know why. Like even in the middle of the match, that you don't know why this is happening. They would show like maggots and crickets and roaches and shit on the from the top down view in the ring. They're projecting this image. Why? And he loses? No. Whatever. Chris Jericho versus Kevin Owens for the United States Championship. I believe this was right after Styles and McMahon. Giant inflatable list of Jericho. He's got a new entrance, does Jericho, but this is probably one of the last times you'll see it, because Kevin Owens wins. He was very dominant throughout this whole match. We didn't see Samoa Joe. We didn't see Finn Balor. But his entrance was basically showing the list of Jericho and counting down from number 10 to break the walls down. And, you know, good on him for, you know, updating it now, but he's probably leaving after this week and won't show up for another 6 months, maybe a year. It'll be very late in this year if he comes back, because he's got duties to do with his band Fozzy. They gotta throw down a new album. They gotta do touring. They've gotta promote it. They've gotta sell albums. Because this is a thing that he's done, you know? Let's see. Brock Lesnar versus Bork Laser versus Goldberg. This match ended the way we knew it was going to. It was a 4 minute 15, 4 minute 20. match between a part-timer who only has two moves and a part-timer who has only about four, maybe. Brock won. We knew it was going to happen. It didn't matter. And I think that's the problem. Oh. And then the part everybody wants to talk about. The wonderful return of the Hardy Boy, the Hardy Boys, their old theme music, introduced into the tag team ladder match for the Raw tag team titles, was Gallows and Anderson, Enzo and Cass, Cesaro and Sheamus, and then the Broken Hardys. And I'm going to say the Broken Hardys because you guys are, WWE is using the word, kind of putting it in there almost mockingly. And after the show, like, they had a Twitter video that went round, and, you know, Matt was semi in broken character. So this is a thing. I want him to lean into it. I want him to go, broken, and he comes out full, you know, full robe, music. He comes out to the Hardy Boys, the Team Extreme Hardy Boys. He comes out, stops, pulls up, please stop this music. I have decreed that this music has been rendered obsolete. For we have not been here in many years. So it is with great brilliance I bring you my new theme. Play my new theme. And it's the piano. Because they own that. That's them. That's what we know. That's what we've loved. That's why we wanted them to come back, is because they've gotten so over. I mean, when people stand in line for 9 hours to meet these two, when 70,000 people are chanting delete, when you have people who can't even mention delete without getting that arm stroke, that delete, 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 and he even did it. That was the thing, they cut away from it, but he did it at the end. Like, right as, because he was standing there in the ring, had the titles in his hand, BT Dubs, the Hardy Boys won. Frickin' Jeff. Dude, he's definitely over 40. When they got to the bottom of the ramp, he goes in there, finds the biggest ladder he can, does a frickin' senton bomb onto it through Cesaro, hitting Sheamus too. He goes through the ladder, through Sheamus, through Cesaro. Sheamus gets hit with, like, his legs and rolls off. It's like, you are insane. How are you still doing what you're doing? You have done this and crazier. Why are you not paralyzed? You are a freak. And we love you. Please don't kill yourself doing these things. Because you are extraordinarily lucky. You are so lucky that you're not paralyzed. But they put out a YouTube video. They put a video out after WrestleMania, you know, kind of in the backstage, proclaiming, you know, they've captured the Raw tag team titles. They said delete. You know, he was in broken character. Go look it up. I'm sure you'll find it on his Twitter. But that was, this moment, The Undertaker and the Hardys return. The Hardys don't balance it. the Hardys on their own, on a single vacuumous moment, were a WrestleMania moment. Probably the best one we've gotten in years. The Undertaker's retirement. Above all else. You're not going to get another moment like that ever. There's never going to be another. Roman Reigns might have won, but he didn't win. He might have recorded a victory, but he lost. We all lost. That pretty much wraps this video up. I do apologize, but there won't be a Raw video tonight. There won't be a SmackDown video tomorrow. I have to close at my job. And before last night, I would have been fine with that. You know what? Yeah, it's a Raw after Mania, but they usually do suck ass at the... I was basing it off of last year, because last year was the first WrestleMania I sat down to watch. You know what? Not worth it. I'll be fine. I can miss that. SmackDown, I'm sad about missing that, but, you know, what have you. I'm going to hate missing it. But, you know, you got to pay bills. So, until next time, Robert the Coroner's Rep. Please like, comment, subscribe. Do all those wonderful things that you do. I have to say a thank you to Beej Adams, who, new subscriber. He subscribed last night while we were over there. I have to thank Corey, my buddy Corey from Bearded Vikings. He drove me, made sure I got home safe. You know, no drinking and driving, not having it. But, I mean, all the guys there were amazing. But, you know, that moment. Thank you, Taker. Just...